Harper Audio presents Sisters-in-Law, How Sandra Day O'Connor and Ruth Bader Ginsburg Went to the Supreme Court and Changed the World, by Linda Hirshman. Read by Andrea Gallo. Author's note. Women's names and titles matter. They are so hard won. The convention in journalism is to add the title justice when introducing a justice or when the role is particularly meaningful to the content of the text. Otherwise, justices are referred to by their last names, Rehnquist, Berger, like any other public figures being discussed. Obama, Biden. I've followed this custom except where another speaker refers to them in some other way. Unlike the male figures who shape the norm, my subjects had different names when they were young, Day and Bader, rather than O'Connor and Ginsburg. When discussing the youthful Sandra Day and Ruth Bader, I usually use their first names. Even Supreme Court justices were kids once. Introduction. Ruffled collars. By the time the nation celebrates the birth of its democracy each 4th of July, the 9 justices of the Supreme Court have mostly left town. But before departing the Capitol for their summer recess, they must first decide all the cases they've heard since their current term began the previous October. The hardest, most controversial cases, where the unelected court orders the society to change in a big way, are often left to the end. As the days for decision tick away in late June, the tension in the courtroom is as hot and heavy as the Washington summer air. On the morning of June 26, 1996, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the second woman appointed to the High Court since its founding, slipped through the red velvet curtain behind the bench and took her seat at the end. 5 places along the majestic curve sat Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, since 1981 the first woman on the Supreme Court, or the FWOTSC, as she slyly called herself. Each woman justice sported an ornamental white collar on her somber black robe, but otherwise, there was no obvious link between the first and second, any more than between any of the other justices. On that day, however, the public got a rare glimpse at the ties that bound the 2 most powerful women in the land. Speaking from the depths of the high-backed chair that towered over her tiny frame, Justice Ginsburg delivered the decision of the court in United States v. Virginia. From that morning in June 1996, Virginia's state-run Virginia Military Institute, which had trained young men since before the Civil War, would have to take females into its ranks. The Constitution of the United States, which required the equal protection of the laws for all persons, including women, demanded it. Women in the barracks at VMI. Women rolling in the mud during the traditional hazing, women with cropped heads and stiff gray uniforms looking uncannily like the Confederate soldiers VMI had sent to the Civil War a century before. 6 of Ginsburg's brethren on the court agreed with her that VMI had to admit women, but the case was much more contentious and momentous than the robust majority of 7 reflects. Until that day, VMI had been the shining symbol of a world divided between men's and women's proper roles. Before the case got to the Supremes, the lower federal courts had supported VMI's sex-segregated ways. For years, opponents of feminism used the prospect of women in military settings as the prime example of how ridiculous the world would become if women were truly treated as equal to men. VMI was one of the last redoubts. And now, Justice Ginsburg, who years ago as Lawyer Ginsburg had been the premier advocate for women's equality, the Thurgood Marshall of the women's movement, was going to order the nation to live in that brave new sex-equal world. Few people listening knew that Ginsburg got to speak for the court that morning because her sister-in-law, O'Connor, had decided she should. After the justices voted to admit women to VMI at their regular conference, the most senior member of the majority had the right to assign the opinion to any justice who agreed. He assigned it to the senior woman, Sandra Day O'Connor, but she wouldn't take it. She knew who had labored as a Supreme Court lawyer at the American Civil Liberties Union from 1970 to 1980 to get the court to call women equal. And now the job was done. "This should be Ruth's," she said. On decision day, justices don't read their whole opinions, which can often run to scores of pages. That morning, Ginsburg chose to include in her summary reading a reference to Justice O'Connor's 1982 opinion in Hogan v. Mississippi, which had prohibited Mississippi from segregating the sexes in the state's public nursing schools. O'Connor's opinion for the closely divided court in Hogan, Ginsburg reminded the listeners, had laid down the rule that states may not close entrance gates based on fixed notions concerning the roles and abilities of males and females. And then Ginsburg, the legendarily undemonstrative justice, paused and, lifting her eyes from her text, met the glance of her predecessor across the bench. She thought of the legacy the two were building together and nodded. Justice Ginsburg resumed reading the opinion. Every woman in America was in the courtroom that June day in 1996. Whether you were a Supreme Court lawyer or a stay-at-home mom, pro-choice or pro-life, single or married, having sex in the city or getting ready for a purity ball, in their journey to that day and on that day, these women changed your life. And so, of course, changed the lives of men as well. Justices O'Connor and Ginsburg have a stunning history of achievement in a wide range of legal decisions. But sisters-in-law tells the story of how together at the pinnacle of legal power, they made women equal before the law. They argued for equality. They were the living manifestations of equality. And because they took power before the revolution was over, they were in the unprecedented position of ordering equality. When women are treated as equals, as Gail Collins memorably said in her best-selling book, everything changes. When I graduated from law school in 1969, one of seven women in a class of 150 to start my career as the only female associate in my firm of 60, the world of the law was the last place where I expected to see change. Interviewers had felt free to tell me their firms didn't hire women and didn't care if I had made law review. When I stood up to argue my first case in the Supreme Court 7 years later, there were just the nine old men. But starting with the admission of serious numbers of women to law school in 1967, and certainly by the time of the Supreme Court decision in Reed v. Reed in 1971, which was decided thanks in part to Ginsburg's work at the ACLU, the world had begun to change. Laws saying that women weren't equal to men, or that men were not as worthy as women, were struck from the statute books, and part of the stereotyped thinking about women's lives went down the drain with them. In 1981, 10 years after Ginsburg began her crusade at the ACLU, President Ronald Reagan appointed an obscure Arizona appellate judge, Sandra Day O'Connor, to the court, and the campaign for women's equality picked up a doughty and determined role model. "It was okay to be first," said O'Connor when the word of her appointment came, "but you don't want to be the last." As they litigated for and modeled the possibility for women to succeed, at the law and in the larger world, my world changed exponentially. I went from being an exotic token to a pretty normal player in the world of law. Of course, they weren't personally responsible for the explosion of women entering the legal profession in the 1970s, but they probably mattered more than anyone else. The next time I stood before the Supreme Court, in 1982, Justice O'Connor looked back at me. She didn't rule my way, but I was still glad she was there. When I began to write about the women's movement, as a law professor and a philosopher, I had Ruth Bader Ginsburg's stirring invocations to women's equality as the raw material of my analysis. All movements have heroes. Who gets to the pantheon is often in dispute. But not in this case. Neither of them is perfect, of course, but Justices Ginsburg and O'Connor are unambiguous heroines of the modern feminist movement, and everyone needs heroes. My journey to the Supreme Court began when I found my models in the little public library behind my elementary school in Cleveland, Ohio. To my eternal good fortune, the library carried a whole bunch of biographies for girls. Florence Nightingale, Jane Addams, Julia Ward Howe, who wrote The Battle Hymn of the Republic, Anne Carroll, who helped devise military strategy for U.S. Grant, Lucy Stone, and then all the suffragettes. By the time I finished the story of Susan B. Anthony, my life course was set. Sandra Day O'Connor and Ruth Bader Ginsburg are the Jane Addamses and the Susan B. Anthonys of the succeeding generations. Each had a long, hard journey to the place where their stories peaked. 40+ years before the announcement of the decision in the VMI case, Justice O'Connor, then a new law school graduate, had been offered a position as a legal secretary. When Justice Ginsburg arrived at Harvard in 1954, the law school's dean asked all 9 women students in her class to explain how they justified taking up a place that would otherwise have gone to a man. In the intervening 40 years, O'Connor and Ginsburg traversed that hostile world to the highest point in the profession. To learn what they did and how they did it is to view 2 very different and surprisingly similar journeys to a flourishing life. O'Connor was appointed in 1981 by a Republican president swept in by a landslide. Ginsburg was put on the court by a centrist Democrat who hadn't even won a majority of the popular vote. They came from completely different backgrounds. Republican, Democrat, Goldwater girl, liberal, Arizona, Brooklyn. Ginsburg, the brunette, opera-loving New Yorker, used to call her blonde colleague the girl of the Golden West. When O'Connor was appointed, Ginsburg, after 10 years in feminist activism, didn't even know who she was. They were not soul sisters. O'Connor, the uncomplaining, open-faced, cheerful, and energetic Westerner, was easy for her brethren to accept in 1981. As Justice John Paul Stevens.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.